Good morning and welcome back. Myself, Dr. Gibran Ahmed, presents to you Simply Pathology, and I hope you're enjoying HIV. So we have already completed the part 1 and the part 2 of HIV, and today is the last part of HIV, and I hope you have completely understood HIV, and I wish that you understand this topic nicely. So let us continue. So the last time we had read about the natural course of HIV infection in details, we had seen that there are three basic stages. First stage is the stage of a primary infection followed by the acute retroviral syndrome. Second is the chronic phase, that is the phase of clinical latency. And thirdly, we were having the acquired immunodeficiency syndrome, that is AIDS. So if you do not have an extra amount of time to read so many things in details, so in that situation, you can just follow this chart. So first, we are going to see the primary infection with HIV or the acute retroviral syndrome. Okay, so initially there is infection of the mucosal tissues followed by death of the mucosal memory CD4 plus T cells. After that, the infection is established in the lymphoid tissues, example the lymph nodes, that is followed by the viremia, that is the spread of the infection throughout the body, an early acute phase of infection, and then an immune response is mounted against that infection, and there is a partial control of the viral infection. So this is the primary infection or the acute retroviral syndrome. The second phase is the chronic phase of clinical latency, which is characterized by establishment of chronic infection. Now here the virus is basically concentrated in the lymphoid tissue, that is the spleen and the lymph node, and there is a low level of virus production. Okay, this is the chronic phase of clinical latency. Okay, and this is followed by the acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. Herein, if you see, there is a in the background of a raised amount of cytokines and infections, there is an increased viral replication. Okay, and this viral replication leads to an increased destruction of the lymphoid tissues with depletion of the CD4 plus T cells, and then the clinical syndrome of acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. Now let us see the clinical course of HIV in this particular graph. So on the this is the clinical course. On the y-axis, we are having the CD4 plus T cells, and we are also having the viremia. So the CD4 plus T cell, okay, in the graph is shown in blue, whereas the viremia is shown in brown. So as you can see, there are three phases, okay. And yes, on the x-axis, we have the time frame, okay. We have weeks and we have years. So the acute infection usually takes and happens in weeks, okay, characterized by acute HIV syndrome, widespread dissemination with seeding of the lymphoid organs. Okay, that is followed by a chronic phase of clinical latency that is often continuing for several years, on an average around 7 to 10 years. Okay, that is the chronic phase, and that is followed by our crisis period, that is the AIDS period, that which is characterized by opportunistic infections and ultimately death of the patient. So this is the clinical course of HIV. Now if you see the immune response to the HIV infection, again on the x-axis we are having the time frame divided into weeks or years, and on the y-axis we are having the magnitude of response. So initially, in the early course of the infection, if you still look at the viral particles initially what happens, that the virus replication increases, okay, in a few weeks it becomes very high, but because of the rise in the cytotoxic T lymphocytes, the level comes down, as you can see in from this diagram. Secondly, you can see the level of cytotoxic T lymphocytes, it raises and becomes maximum around 12 weeks. Okay, it starts to rise within 2 to 3 weeks and become and peaks at around 9 to 12 weeks, and it mounts an immune response against the initial viral replication and tries to curb down the viral replication. Okay, then we also have the anti-p24 antibody, okay, which is also starting around few weeks later, okay, along with the anti-envelope antibodies. Okay, now what are the opportunistic infections in HIV infection? Let us look at that. So the AIDS defining opportunistic infection and neoplasm found in patients with HIV infection, we are going to read about them in details today in this lecture. So we can have protozoal infection, which is characterized by cryptosporidiosis, pneumocystosis, toxoplasmosis. We have the fungal infections characterized by the candidiasis, cryptococcosis, coccidiomycosis and histoplasmosis. Bacterial infections, which is mycobacterial. Again, mycobacterial infection can be atypical or typical. So atypical mycobacterial infection can be your Mycobacterium avium intracellular infection, whereas the typical is your Mycobacterium tuberculosis. So this Mycobacterium avium intracellular infection can be disseminated or extrapulmonary, whereas the mycobacterial tuberculosis is pulmonary or extrapulmonary. Again, there can be nocardiosis as well as salmonellosis. So when we come to the viral infections, basically there is cytomegalovirus infection, herpes simplex virus infection, varicella zoster infection, and PMLE, that is progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy caused by the JC virus. And we are having neoplasm. Actually, there are three basic neoplasm, which is also the AIDS defining malignancy. That is Kaposi sarcoma, primary lymphoma of the brain, invasive carcinoma of the uterine cervix. Okay. So one important thing is, along with the primary lymphoma of the brain, the one very important thing is the non-Hodgkin lymphomas, which is very, very important in case of AIDS. Okay. So let us now see the infections. So untreated HIV patients, around 15-30% of the untreated HIV patients, they suffer from pneumonia. And most commonly this pneumonia is due to the reactivation of pneumocystis jirovicii infection. Now the incidence of such pneumonia has come down because of the institution of antiretroviral therapy. Now the most common opportunistic infection in AIDS pneumonia, okay, it is pneumocystis jirovicii. But if the question is the most common organism to cause pneumonia in HIV, then your answer will be Streptococcus pneumonia. The most common fungal infection in HIV or AIDS in world as well as in India, the answer is candidiasis. It can be oral, vaginal or esophageal candidiasis. Okay. Now the cytomegalovirus, if we come to the cytomegalovirus, it causes a disseminated disease or it can also cause a localized disease. Most commonly the cytomegalovirus is affecting the eyes and the GIT. Now this CMV retinitis occurs when the CD4 plus T cell count becomes less than 50 cells per microliter. In the GI tract, the CMV can cause colitis and esophagitis. Now remember, AIDS patient, they also present with disseminated atypical mycobacterial infection. Okay, it occurs late in the setting of severe immunosuppression when the CD4 plus T cell count is less than 50 cells per microliter. Now remember, globally, the most common opportunistic infection in AIDS is mycobacterial tuberculosis. Okay. Now, the patients with AIDS, they are at an increased risk of the reactivation of a latent pulmonary, tuberculosis as well as the primary infection. So what they are saying, that person who is suffering from AIDS, okay, he can either have a reactivation of the pulmonary tuberculosis, okay, or he can have a primary infection, a new infection with tuberculosis. In contrast to the atypical Mycobacterium tuberculosis, the typical or the usual Mycobacterium tuberculosis manifests early in the course of disease. The most common opportunistic infection in AIDS in India is M. tuberculosis, as well as globally it is Mycobacterium tuberculosis. Now let us see what are the CNS infections which happens in AIDS. So the protozoal infections can be divided into two. There is a cryptococcal infection and there is a Toxoplasma gondii infection. So cryptococcal infection, if you see, it involves 10% cases of AIDS and most commonly presents as cryptococcal meningitis, whereas Toxoplasma gondii most commonly it accounts for 50% of all the mass lesions in the central nervous system. Now there is another virus called as the JC virus, which is responsible for progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy. Now another important feature of HIV or AIDS, is your persistent diarrhea. Again, it can be caused by Cryptosporidium isosporabelli, okay, or it can be caused by enteric bacteria like Salmonella and Shigella. Both of them classically causes profuse chronic watery diarrhea with massive fluid loss, okay. Another virus is your herpes simplex virus, which basically causes mucocutaneous ulcers in the mouth, esophagus, external genitalia, and in the perianal region. Okay. Now, if you look at the another very important topic is the association of the CD4 plus T cell count and the infections. So different levels of CD4 plus T cell count is associated with different kinds of infection. Remember, there is a very high risk of opportunistic infection when the CD4 plus T cell count becomes less than 200 per cubic millimeter. So when the count is more than 300, there is a high risk of the typical mycobacterial infection, that is Mycobacterium tuberculosis. When the count becomes less than 300, there is an increased risk of candidiasis, that is there is an oral thrush, oral hairy leukoplakia caused by EBV, protozoan infections by cryptosporidiosis, isospora belli and microsporidia. Now when the count becomes less than 200, there is an increased risk of PCP, that is pneumocystis jerviki pneumonia, HIV associated nephropathy, trypanosomiasis also called as Chagas disease, lymphomas and toxoplasmosis. Okay. Now when the count is less than 100, in that case there is a high chance of cryptococcal neoformin infection as well as infection with Bartonella henseli causing bacillary angiomatosis. And when the count is less than 50 per cubic millimeter, there is a high chance of cytomegalovirus retinitis, and very important is your Mycobacterium avian complex infection. This is the atypical mycobacterial infection. Also there is an increased risk of primary CNS lymphoma and something called as iris. Is basically an immune reconstitution inflammatory syndrome which is characterized by a paradoxical worsening symptoms after starting the ART therapy. Now what are the most commons in HIV? So most commons in HIV, let us see. The most common opportunistic infection in HIV globally is Mycobacterium tuberculosis. In India, it is Mycobacterium tuberculosis. In AIDS pneumonia, if the question is AIDS pneumonia, then the answer will be pneumocystis pneumonia. The most common fungal infection in HIV or AIDS is candidiasis. The most common cancer in AIDS is non-Hodgkin lymphoma more than Kaposi sarcoma. Remember, why we are using the term cancer over here? Remember, Kaposi sarcoma, though the term uses sarcoma, usually early in the course of disease, Kaposi sarcoma is polyclonal in nature. So it is not malignant early on in the case. So if your MCQ is stating cancer, then you say non-Hodgkin lymphoma more than Kaposi sarcoma. But if your question is stating most common neoplasm in it, then your answer will be Kaposi sarcoma. The most common neurological manifestation in HIV is your AIDS dementia complex. The most common skeletal muscle disorder is inflammatory myopathies. Most common organism to cause pneumonia in HIV is Streptococcus pneumonia. Most common hematological manifestation in AIDS is autoimmune hemolytic anemia. Most common space occupying lesion of the central nervous system in HIV or AIDS is toxoplasmosis. Whereas the most common space occupying tumor of the brain in HIV is primary CNS lymphoma. Moving ahead, the most common associated hepatitis in HIV is hepatitis B, 90% cases. The most common renal disorder in HIV is associated nephropathy. The most common endocrinopathy in HIV is lipodystrophy. The most common dermatological manifestation in HIV is seborrheic dermatitis. So this is all about the most commons in HIV. Now we are going to start with a very, very important part, that is the tumors in HIV infection. So what are the tumors in HIV infection? The patients with AIDS, they have an increased incidence of Kaposi sarcoma, B-cell lymphoma, cervical cancer in women and anal carcinoma in men. Around 25-40% of the untreated HIV infected patients, they present with malignancy because of DNA viruses. For example, the herpes virus is causing Kaposi sarcoma, Epstein-Barr virus causes B-cell lymphomas, human papilloma virus causes cervical as well as anal carcinoma. Now all these carcinomas, they are happening because in conditions of reduced immunity like in AIDS, there is a reactivation of all these DNA viruses. Now first we are going to discuss the Kaposi sarcoma. It is the most common neoplasm in patients with AIDS, but remember the most common cancer if they ask, then you should write about non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. With ART, the incidence has reduced. Now remember, the lesions of Kaposi sarcoma is characterized by proliferation of spindle-shaped cells which is expressing the marker of both endothelial as well as smooth muscle cell. So basically they are trying to say that these spindle-shaped cells are derived from both the endothelial cell as well as smooth muscle cell. Then there will be a profusion of a slit-like vascular spaces suggesting that the tumor is arising from the primitive mesenchymal precursors of vascular channel. So they are arising from the endothelial cells, from the vascular channel. They will form the primitive mesenchymal precursors. Now many features suggest that it is not a malignant tumor as many spindle cells are polyclonal. Although in more advanced disease, they show monoclonality. Now remember, Kaposi sarcoma occurs because of HHV-8, that is human herpes virus 8 or Kaposi sarcoma herpes virus. HHV-8 establishes latent infection, and then it produces certain protein, that is the cyclin D homolog okay, as well as inhibitors of p53. So both of these conditions leads to unchecked proliferation of the spindle cells and prevention of apoptosis. Remember that HHV8 alone cannot cause Kaposi sarcoma. Okay, remember HHV8 only in conditions of altered immunity or reduced immunity, for example AIDS or HIV, they will cause Kaposi sarcoma. Remember one more thing, that HHV8 is also associated with rare B-cell lymphomas, that is a primary efficient lymphoma, and B-cell lymphoproliferative disorders like multicentric Castleman's disease. Now Kaposi sarcoma associated with HIV is usually more widespread and tends to be more aggressive in nature than the classical Kaposi sarcoma. Now the second important cancer that is taking place in HIV is lymphomas. So you have to understand, okay, the kind of lymphoma that is occurring early on in the course of disease and that occurs in advanced infection is different. So early on in the course of disease, the HIV infection causes increased number of follicular T helper cells, which causes germinal center B cell hyperplasia. Okay, and this germinal center B cell hyperplasia increases the risk of B cell lymphomas with translocation. For example, Burkitt's lymphoma with MYC translocation and large B cell lymphoma with BCL6 translocation. Now, in case of advanced infection, okay, there is a T cell depletion. So, and there is an unchecked Epstein-Barr virus or Kaposi sarcoma herpes virus reactivation in latently infected B cell, which leads to virus associated B cell lymphomas, especially Epstein-Barr virus positive large cell lymphoma, HHV8 positive primary efficient lymphoma, and Epstein-Barr virus positive Hodgkin's lymphoma. So these are the basic lymphomas. Now we are going to see in details the pathogenesis of lymphomas. So remember that 5% of the patients of AIDS present with lymphoma and another 5% will develop lymphoma during their course. Now with the ART therapy, the incidence of lymphomas have gone down, but still the incidence of lymphoma in AIDS patient is 10 times more than the general population. So now we are going to discuss the mechanism of increased B cell tumor in HIV infected individual. The first mechanism that we are going to study is unchecked proliferation of the B cells infected with oncogenic herpes virus in the setting of profound T cell depletion, that is AIDS. So you have to understand that the T cell immunity is needed to restrain the proliferation of the B cells infected with oncogenic virus such as EBV and KSHV. So with AIDS, this protection from the T cells is lost because the T cell itself is depleted. This gives rise to aggressive B cell lymphoma. So by adulthood, most normal individuals are infected with HIV. Okay, Epstein-Barr virus persists in such individuals as latent infection, that is 1 in 1 lakh B cell, and they form memory B cells. If he or she becomes infected with HIV, okay, then what will happen? If he or she becomes infected with HIV, there is a reactivation of the Epstein-Barr virus, increased B cell growth promoting cytokine, that is interleukin-6, and chronic infection with pathogens that stimulate the B cells. All these three conditions is going to cause Epstein-Barr virus infected B cell clones to proliferate, and additional somatic mutations will occur, which will lead to a full blown Epstein-Barr virus positive B cell lymphoma. Okay, and the tumor basically occurs in the extra nodal sites, for example, the central nervous system, gut, orbit, lungs, and also there's the risk of primary efficient lymphomas by Epstein-Barr virus plus human herpes virus. So if I just repeat this part again, okay, just let me repeat this part. By adulthood, most normal individuals, they are infected with HIV, not HIV, it is EBV. There is a correction to be made over here. There is a misprint. By adulthood, most normal individuals are infected with Epstein-Barr virus. Okay, Epstein-Barr virus persists in such individuals as a latent infection. Okay, inside the memory cells. Now, if they become infected with HIV, what HIV does? HIV will directly reactivate the Epstein-Barr virus. It will also cause release of increased amount of B cell growth promoting cytokine, that is interleukin-6, and it is also going to increase the amount of opportunistic infections. So all these three things is going to stimulate Epstein-Barr virus infected B cell clones to proliferate. With additional mutations, there will be full blown Epstein-Barr virus positive B cell lymphoma, and the tumor classically occurs in the extranodal sites, and primary efficient lymphomas, okay, they have a role of both Epstein-Barr virus as well as Kaposi sarcoma herpes virus. I hope this part is clear. Now, the second mechanism of causation of lymphoma is the germinal center B cell hyperplasia in the setting of early HIV infection. So, even in HIV infected patients with a normal CD4 plus count, the chances of lymphoma increases, and it is not associated with any kind of virus, not associated with Epstein-Barr virus or KHSV. It occurs due to profound B cell hyperplasia early on in the course of disease. So, you have to understand one thing, as we have already read in our normal immune system videos, that you have to remember that in the germinal centers, normally the B cells is undergoing two things. One is the class switching, one is the somatic hypermutation in their immunoglobulin genes. These two processes are AID dependent process. And these two processes, that is the somatic hypermutation and the class switching, they are error prone. Why? Because both these processes, they introduce DNA breaks, which may lead to translocation of oncogenes and activation of the oncogenes. So these are the mistakes that the body can make. So these are the places where normally the body can make errors. Okay. So what happened that in HIV infection, this normal process increases. Why? Because of excessive B cell hyperplasia. So as HIV stimulates B cell hyperplasia, the chances of acquiring the DNA breaks is also increased because of the rise in the number of B cells at risk. Okay. So just once more, I'm going to explain you this concept that normally in our germinal center, the B cell undergoes class switching and somatic hypermutation. So this process in normal situation also is quite error prone. Okay. And these are areas where there can be errors. Because of the errors, there can be activation, there can be translocation leading to activation of oncogenes. This chance or this risk is very small in normal people. But as the person gets infected with HIV, it causes excessive B cell hyperplasia. So the amount of class switching and somatic hypermutation, the frequency of these events increases. So the chances of making errors also increases. That is why even in the absence of any kind of infection, the HIV itself, by increasing the number of B cell hyperplasia, can increase the chances of mutation and acquiring translocation of oncogenes leading to lymphomas. Okay. Here, the aggressive tumors of the B cells, they arise outside the setting of full-blown AIDS. So it is early on in the course. So two important lymphomas that is present early on is Burkitt's lymphoma because of mutation in MYC, which is a translocation, and DLBCL, that is diffuse large B cell lymphoma, because of mutations in BCL6. So this is all about the lymphomas. Now, other Epstein-Barr virus related proliferation, if you see, Epstein-Barr virus can also lead to Hodgkin's lymphoma, as well as it can lead to oral hairy leukoplakia. Okay. Now, HIV and lymphoma, there are certain important MCQs. Remember, lymphoma occurs in HIV infection when the CD4 plus T cell count becomes less than 200 cells per cubic millimeter. Now, the AIDS defining lymphoma, remember, is only the non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. Okay. And non-Hodgkin lymphomas that occurs in AIDS can be divided into immunoblastic lymphomas comprising of DLBCL and primary efficient lymphoma. Then we are having Burkitt's lymphoma, and then there is a primary CNS lymphoma. Remember, among them, the most common is your immunoblastic type, and among the immunoblastic type, the most common is DLBCL. So the most common type of lymphoma in HIV is the immunoblastic type. Okay. Now, what are the other tumors that occurs in HIV? Okay, associated with the human papilloma, HPV virus, that is the human papilloma virus, we are having an increased risk of cervical cancer, as well as the pre-invasive cervical cancer lesions called as squamous intraepithelial lesions or SILs. Now, the risk of squamous intraepithelial lesion increases 10 times in HIV, and the risk increases when the CD4 plus T cell count becomes less than 500 cells per cubic millimeter. Now, the risk of anal carcinomas, that is HPV associated anal carcinomas, also increases. So one important MCQ, the AIDS defining malignancies are your Kaposi sarcoma, non-Hodgkin lymphoma, and cervical and anal carcinoma. Okay. Now remember, Hodgkin's lymphoma also occur in HIV, but it is not AIDS defining malignancy. Okay. And the most common type of Hodgkin's lymphoma that occurs in HIV is your mixed cellularity variety. Now let us talk about the CNS involvement in HIV. Already we have read about the tumors in details. Now 40-60% of the HIV patients, they have clinically apparent neurological dysfunction, but 90% of such patients demonstrate some neurological abnormality at autopsy. So in addition to the infections and neoplasm, there can be meningoencephalitis, aseptic meningitis, vascular myelopathy, peripheral neuropathies, progressive encephalopathy, which is also called as HIV associated neurocognitive disorder. It is the most common actually. Okay, now the last leg is the diagnosis of HIV infection. Okay, normally the CD4 plus T cell count is around 500 to 1000 cells per cubic millimeter. The diagnosis of the AIDS is made when the CD4 plus T cell count becomes less than 200 cells per cubic millimeter, and those who are positive with ELISA for HIV infection. So most sensitive or the best screening test is ELISA, whereas the most specific test is your Western blot. The best investigation to detect HIV in the window period, that is the first 2 to 4 weeks of infection, is to go for the P24 antigen assay by RT-PCR. So with this, we have completed the HIV infection. Hope you have enjoyed this lecture. Thank you very much for watching, and thanks for your feedback. And if you have any doubts, please do comment, and please do subscribe to my channel if you haven't yet. Thank you very much, guys.